Listening Library presents A Brief History of Montmaray by Michelle Cooper, read for you by Emma Bering. This is the journal of Sophia Margaret Elizabeth Jane Clementine Fitzosborne, begun this 23rd day of October 1936, on the occasion of her 16th birthday. 23rd October 1936. Dear Sophie, happy birthday to my favorite little sister. I've been trying to recollect the day you were born so I can gush about it in an appropriately sentimental fashion, but I'm afraid it's all a blank. I must have been too busy pulling Veronica's hair or smearing stewed apple over my smock to notice you popping into existence. I do remember Henry's arrival 10 years ago, and if you were anything like her, you were a most unattractive baby, wrinkled, red-faced, loud, and rather smelly. Lucky for all of us that you've improved somewhat with age. Now, did the presents arrive safely? I had to go all the way to Knightsbridge for the journal, and then I got detention for sneaking off from games, so I hope you appreciate it. You can use it to write down your thoughts. You must have plenty of them at the moment, given Aunt Charlotte's letter. I assume you've read it by now. Are you thrilled? Terrified? Well, it's all your fault for turning 16. You gave Aunt Charlotte quite a shock when she realized how old you'd suddenly become. She had to sit down and have an extra large sherry to recover. As for me, this new school is almost as ghastly as the old one. I suppose I'd been hoping Rupert would come too when I was thrown out of Eton, but his parents kept saying no. Worse luck. The housemasters have finally sorted out dormitories, and now I share with three boys. Two are in the rugby first 15. Ugh. The other has noxious feet and learns the bagpipes, so is nearly as bad. I have already had two detentions, one for missing games on Saturday and one for not doing Latin prep. The Latin prep wasn't my fault. I didn't know there was any prep because the Latin master told us about it in Latin and I didn't understand a word he said. Remember, I am in March Hare House, so please make sure you put that on the address when you write, otherwise the letters might get lost. It's a good house to be in because it inevitably comes last in the house cup, so no one cares much when I lose house points. The other good thing about March Hare is that we can climb out to the top story windows onto the roof and look into the hospital next door, which is very educational. Also, sometimes the nurses come out onto a balcony to smoke and they throw us a cigarette if we beg nicely. It's almost lights out, so I'd better finish. Tell Veronica to come and live in my trunk so she can secretly do my Latin prep for me. She could write my history essay as well. It is on the Restoration. And ask her to bring Carlos with her so he can eat the bagpipes. Love from your wonderful brother, Toby. As usual, Toby's letter was coded in Kernitan, which Toby and my cousin Veronica and I invented years ago so we could write notes to each other without the grown-ups being able to read them. Kernitan is based on Cornish and Latin, with some Greek letters and random meaningless squiggles thrown in to be extra confusing. Also, it is boustrophedonic. I adore that word and try to say it as often as possible, but unfortunately it hasn't many everyday uses. Boustrophedonic means you read one line left to right, then the next right to left. Veronica can translate Kernitan straight off the page into English, but I find it much easier to write it out. So there it is, my first entry in my new journal. It has 100 blank pages thick as parchment and a Morocco binding and is almost too lovely to write in. I did get some superb birthday presents this year. Veronica gave me a pen with my initials on it. From my little sister, Henry, came a new Pride and Prejudice because I dropped my old one in the bath and it hasn't been the same since. Henry, who wishes she'd been born a boy, looked quite disappointed when I opened the journal from Toby. She'd probably told him to get me one of those pocket knives with attached magnifying glass, screwdriver and fish scaler, hoping that I'd then lend it to her. The villagers presented me with a honey spice cake, a lavender pillow, and a beautiful comb carved out of driftwood. Uncle John doesn't even know what year it is, let alone the date, so I never expect so much as a happy birthday from him. But Rebecca, our housekeeper, gave me the day off from washing up the breakfast dishes. Even Carlos, our Portuguese water dog, managed a birthday card, signed with an inky paw print. Now I understand why Henry was being so secretive yesterday and how the bathtub ended up with all those black streaks. And then there was Aunt Charlotte. I opened her letter long after breakfast was over, because I couldn't imagine her approving of anything as indulgent as birthdays. But that turned out to be the most exciting part of the whole morning. I won't copy it all out, most of it being her usual scolding about our idle, extravagant lives here on Montmaray, and do we think she's made of money, and so on. But here is the important part. And now that you are 16, Sophia, I am reminded yet again of the sad burden I have been forced to bear since my youngest brother and his wife were so cruelly torn from this world. God rest their souls. My only comfort is knowing how grateful Robert and Jane would be if they could see all that I have done for you children. However, my responsibilities are not yet complete, and your mother in particular, Sophia, would have wanted you to be given the same social opportunities she had. As for Veronica, it is not her fault that her feckless mother is who knows where and quite unable to make appropriate arrangements regarding a matrimonial match. I feel it is my duty, then, to sponsor your debuts into society. We cannot postpone this event much longer, in light of your advancing ages. I expect early in the new year would be the best time for both of you to travel to England. I leave it to Veronica to write to Mr. Grenville regarding steamer passage and railway tickets. In the meantime, I shall begin perusing the Almanach de Gotha for eligible prospects. I took a moment to savor that glorious phrase. Your debuts into society. Then raced off to the library tower at the far end of the courtyard in search of Veronica. She had locked the little black cat out, and it was crying with rage on the doorstep. The door was barred from the inside too, not just closed. I had to hammer at it for ages before she peered out. "Oh, sorry," she said, opening the door wider. "I thought it was Henry being annoying again." "No, you can't come in," she told the cat. But it had already shot past my legs and launched itself at Veronica. "Oh, for heaven's sake," she huffed. But the cat only curled its claws into her skirt and wailed harder. All the castle cats are a bit mad. I'm not sure why. The ones down in the village seem quite normal. I thrust the letter at Veronica, threw myself upon the shredded-looking chaise longue, and glanced around while I waited for her to read it. Behind me were the tower stairs, winding their way up through five stories of books, most of which are bound in royal blue and stamped with the Fitzosborne crest. Veronica's domain, on the ground floor, is a large, square room that could be handsome if it tried. However, Veronica would rather it be serviceable, and so the desk is an old wooden door set on trestles. The papers on it are weighed down with stones. The walls that aren't hidden behind bookshelves are papered with navigation charts and genealogy lists, and everything reeks of tansy, which smoulders in a little clay pot to ward off insects. "Well?" I burst out as she refolded the letter with her usual precision and prepared to hand it back to me. "We can make our debuts next season, can't we? Do say yes." Why are you asking me? Veronica plucked the cat off her skirt and deposited the wild-eyed creature next to me. It had stopped yowling by then. It immediately began sharpening its claws on the armrest. Aunt Charlotte's the one who'd do the presenting at court. I can't remember all the rules, but she was married to a British subject, so I'm sure that's all right. Yes, yes, she was presented after her wedding, but we'll find the money for dresses and shoes.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.